तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। वी आर इन पंचदशी चैप्टर 4 वर्स नंबर 68 एंड लास्ट वीक वी सॉ व्हाट इज द डिस्पोजिशन ऑफ अ वाइज मैन। Can a wise man, after having purified his manorajya and kama krodha, etc., etc., can he get disturbed or can he not get disturbed? And if he gets disturbed, what he should do? And here it was told in 66 verse, Vikshipyate kadachit dhihi karmana bhogadayina puna samahita sasyat tadaiva abhyasa patavata. Vikshipyate kadachit dhihi. कदाचित समटाइम्स धी ही इंटेलेक्ट विक्षिप्यते डिस्टर्ब्ड। सो वी डोंट वांट टू बी डिस्टर्ब बट थॉट्स इरप्ट इन अवर माइंड, व्हाट कैन यू डू अबाउट इट? एजिटेटिंग थॉट्स कम, फ्रस्ट्रेटिंग थॉट्स कम, रेस्टलेस थॉट्स कम, सम योर आईज आर लुकिंग एट समथिंग एंड योर माइंड इज सडनली बिकॉज ऑफ समथिंग इट गेट्स एजिटेटेड। दैट इज नॉट योर बिहेवियर, यू आर एसेंशियली पीस बट because of your contemplation, etc., etc. But then, it triggers off something. So what you should, karmana bhogadayina. And why do we get agitated? It is, don't blame anyone for it. You are getting agitated, or a wise man is, if he is practicing all this sadhana, and he is getting agitated, it is only because of your own karmas, because of your own impressions, because of your own subconscious impressions. It is getting, those subconscious impressions are getting an opportunity to express themselves. Therefore, if this is the case, if it is happening sometimes, then don't get disturbed. What you should do? Puna samahita sasyat. Again and again, remain equanimous to the disturbances, recognize that the disturbances are of the mind and not of your, you are not the disturbance, you can never be disturbed. Why? You are the self, you are the unchanging reality. So remain equanimous. If at the level of mind, all you can remain is non-reactionary towards anything that is erupting in the mind. And if that is also not taking place, then chant elongated ohms. That was told, Dirgham Pranavam Uchcharya Manorajya Viliyate. So if you chant elongated ohms with the outgoing breath, automatically the mental eruptions which are coming for no reason at all, they are just coming from somewhere, they will start subsiding. Tad eva abhyasa patavat, and do this practice again and again and again and again. And one must not get dejected if even after, I sat for 2 hours meditation and after meditation I started barking like a dog towards everyone. It happens. Don't react to it. If you react to it, then you will feel guilty, then you will feel, oh my God. If you want to take it that way, then it should lead to, oh Lord, how much am I, you are making me do, and still I am reacting. I don't know what to do about this. You take it away from me. When that genuine call to the Lord comes, then it will go away. Which means the reason these eruptions or disturbances are coming in the mind, there's, I can think of only one thing, and that is your value giving to the world has not finished yet. That is the only thing. We have not become intoxicated with the divine theme yet. Still little bit, the moment we, when we are in meditation, we are enjoying, but when we come out, we are still attracted, we are still distracted, we are still desirous of the world. That is why these things are happening. And therefore, here it is told that with regards to God and Guru, one must not practice Advaita Bhav. With God and Guru, we must practice Dvaita. We must surrender, we must serve, we must keep quiet in front of them, we must ask questions which are pertaining to the self or the Lord, etc., etc. There, Swamiji, if Anubhavanji comes, acha, Anubhavanji is a sannyasi, I am also a sannyasi. Hi, mate. Doesn't work that. Because you are a sannyasi, then you should be, one must not forget from where, with regards to gurus and mahatmas and God, one must bend down, one must bow down, one must have reverence. It will help. Why? We saw the Ishwara Srishti, isn't it, in this chapter? So the phenomena of individuality is happening. You can't do anything about it. Sab pudha samahita syat, and if you fall again, sometimes if you find yourself that you have come down from that level of disposition, then practice again and come back to it, like a small child who falls many times but keeps getting up till he starts running. Tada eva abhyasa patavat, by practicing again and again and never forgetting for a moment that every step forward is by his grace alone, not by our efforts. The importance of steadfast mind is stressed in 67th verse. Vikshepo yasya nastasya brahma vitvam na manyate brahmai vayamiti prahuhu munaya paradarshinaha. Vikshepo yasya nastasya brahma vitvam na manyate. A wise man who does not have any disturbances and projections, meaning vikshepa. Vikshepa is the disturbance and the manorajya in his mind, projections in his mind, and is not considered to be merely a knower of Brahman. Brahma vitvam na manyate. A knower of Brahman is essentially Brahman alone. So he is not just merely a knower. We are knowers of Brahman. How? Objectively. We know the word Brahman, and we keep reading books after books and texts after texts, going to satsangs after satsangs, and still that Brahman has not been accepted as subjective. Still, by default, the mind goes thinking about Brahman rather than accepting it as the subjective self. See? But the wise man who has purified his mind, who has known Brahman, he is established in Brahman, he is Brahman. Brahma ivaya miti prahu munaya paradarshinaha. But he is considered to be Brahman indeed by contemplative seers of Vedanta. And in this way, the one who knows Brahman is Brahman. Brahmavit brahmaiva bhavati. This is the statement. Brahmavit, vit means to know, Brahma means the Brahman. The one who knows Brahman, brahmaiva bhavati. Bhavati is the to be. He is Brahman alone. So then, what has happened here? The subject has come to know the subject without a thought. Thought appears in the mind only when there is subject-object duality. Now, the subject is thinking about the subject, the theme, the objective theme is the subject alone. How can it be possible? It is not possible. The eyes, the object of seeing of the eyes is the eyes itself. What will happen? The world will vanish. You try in your own spare time. Try to look with your eyes, at your eyes only. The whole, all, everything will melt away. Even while your eyes are open. Do the same thing. You try to hear the where the sound is created on your eardrum. You keep, become focused absolutely. Everything will, only Om will remain. If you practice from where does the pronunciation in your mouth, in your throat, where, if we are saying Om, where is this Om coming? Whatever is the expression, objective expression that you want to, whatever you want to know, if that is subtler than the means of knowledge, that means will vanish. See? So if you put your attention on the source of the sound will vanish. If you put the source of vision, the vision will vanish. If you put the attention on the source of the hearing will vanish. Meaning it will become unmanifest, the gross one. Similarly, if you make the mind to think about its source, the mind will vanish. So when subject is thinking requires subject and object. When the subject is thinking about the subject, the objective thoughts about the subject, they start sublimating, they start vanishing, they start melting away. That is what is told here. So such should be our sadhana. That again and again, we must not struggle with thoughts. We must not struggle with emotions. We must not struggle with the world. We must not struggle with the mind. Instead, if the mind is the tool, let the mind contemplate on the source. It will vanish by itself. Just like you don't struggle with the day, with the sleep. You only keep thinking of the sleep, which is subtler than waking and dream. And the waking world and the dream world vanishes slowly, slowly. This afternoon it happened just like that. I ate lunch and I had still a few things to do, but I sat there watching the match and I don't know when. It was just pulling away inside. You saw the Sixers? Yeah, beautiful shots. But it just gets sucked in. The sleep. Why? Eyes are open and listening, ears are listening to the match, but the attention is more on the sleep. Then even if that blaring TV is there, it does not matter. It seems as if it is not there. And then someone gets, Swamiji, you are not disturbed, you are sleeping, TV is going on so loud, match is going on, but your mind is not available to it. Ears are open, but they are not available to the sound. Mind is there, but it is not available. It has become unmanifest. Why? Naturally, no struggle. Exactly like that. Duplicate it on the journey to the self. If the tool, we only try to fight. This is just tools given to sublimate the mind, Manorajya and the anger, greed, jealousy, etc., etc. But the easiest, keep doing that. But also keep practicing on the side. Whenever the mind settles down a little bit due to those exercises, immediately put the attention on the subject itself. Till here we had done last time. This is also said in Vashishtha Rishi to Lord Rama in the Yoga Vashishtha. No, in what? Mundaka Upanishad. दर्शना दर्शने हित्वा दर्शना दर्शने हित्वा स्वयं केवल रूपतः स्वयं केवल रूपतः यस्तिष्ठति सतु ब्रह्मन् यस्तिष्ठति सतु ब्रह्मन् ब्रह्मन ब्रह्मवित् स्वयं ब्रह्मन ब्रह्मवित् स्वयं दर्शन अदर्शन हित्वा सो ही हु हैज स्वयं केवल रूपतः हित्वा मीन्स रिनाउंस्ड गिवन अप ही हु हैज गिवन अप थॉट्स लाइक आई नो ब्रह्मन आई डोंट नो ब्रह्मन आई नो रियालिटी आई डोंट नो रियालिटी आई नो सेल्फ आई डोंट नो सेल्फ ही हैज गॉन ही इज रियलाइजिंग वॉट दैट Whatever word he speaks about the reality, it is only keeping that separation intact. He has to give up this, give this up once and for all. So, he who has renounced the language like I know Brahman and I don't know Brahman and is established in his essential pure nature, yas tishthati satu Brahman. So, what is that essential nature where he is established? Brahman, the reality, the divinity. Brahmana Brahma with Swayam, he is indeed, O great one, not merely a knower of Brahman, but is Brahman himself. Brahma with Brahma eva bhavati. So, if someone, we have seen Tejomayananji, we have seen Anubhavananji, people come, Swamiji, do you know the truth? Some people, some Mahatmas, they will say, Anubhavananji, why should I tell you? He will never get straight answer. Because the truth is, if you say with words that I know Brahman, it is false. And if you say I don't know Brahman, that is also false. Isn't it? So, if you say with words, I know Brahman, mind is saying, because speech is an gross expression of the mind, and mind is saying, I know Brahman. Mind can never come to know Brahman. Reality. And if mind says, I don't know Brahman, but you are experiencing any given moment that you are alive. See? So, both statements become null and void, and therefore, one must not go into arguments about this, one must not discuss about this, one must not try to prove to someone else, but I am Brahman, but people don't understand me, you know that I am reality. They don't fall at my feet, they don't do prayers for me, they don't give me importance. People don't realize that I am realized. Huh? This is cry of many people. I have come across such people. It's all mental projection. And in this way, he who remains kevala rupataha, in Yoga Sutra also, kevala samadhi comes. So kevala samadhi is beyond nirvikalpa samadhi. Nirvikalpa samadhi also comes and goes. It's a state of mind, nirvikalpa samadhi. It's a state of mind. So whether it is drishyanuvit savikalpa samadhi, whether it is shabdanuvit savikalpa samadhi, whether it is nirvikalpa samadhi, all of them are states of mind. Because you come out of it and go into it. Whereas reality is not coming and going. You are always alive, you are always conscious, you are always the Chaitanya Swarup. Your presence is never becoming absent. So therefore, it is not coming and going. Recognize this about yourself. He who remains in the Kevala Rupa, that is in which all three types of differences or Vedas, what are they? Vijatiya, Sajatiya and Swagata Ved. So what are Vijatiya Ved? You remember? Many times it has come before. You remember Vijatiya, Sajatiya and Swagata Bhed?
Different species.
So what is Vijatiya?
Different species.
So we jati means species, vijati means difference between many species. So human species, animal species, plant species, mountain species, etc., etc., etc. So this is human species can never become animal species. Animal species can never become plant species, isn't it? So these are different species. Then sajatiya, sa means similar.
Same.
Species, differences of species within one species. So within the plant kingdom, there are species of banyan trees, there are species of neem trees, there are species, so many different. Within human beings, there are people from America, from India, from Australia, from different within human beings. And swagata, within one unit of any species, the differences. So if you take human beings, in one human being, what are the differences? Head is not the feet, hands are not, is left hand and right hand and head and nose. And this is swagata. Differences within one. So these three types of differences are absent in such a person who is abiding in the self. So then what will be his vision?
Everything.
Everything will be experienced as self alone, without a thought. Then only it will happen. Because the moment thought comes, but Swamiji, how is it possible? You cannot come to know what scriptures are saying till you don't realize yourself. Because mind does not have the capacity to work it out. We are trying to work it out. To some extent we can. But after that we cannot. Brahman satu swayam, Brahman na brahmavet. Oh great one. He is Brahman, he is not the knower of Brahman, but he is the Brahman himself. He is not knowing the Brahman or the reality objectively. He is experiencing the reality subjectively. Even when his eyes are open, he is looking at the world, he is hearing the world, he is experiencing the world. This is what we talk about great masters, isn't it? But he is in his whole being, mind, senses, body. So when he looks at his mind, he is experiencing it as self. When he looks at his senses, he experiences it as self. When he looks at this body or every other body, for him, that body and this body is one and the same. And that also he is experiencing as self. He is experiencing every sentient and insentient thing in this world and being in this world as the self. This is his disposition. And how is he experiencing this? Without a thought. Just like you experience the bliss of sleep without a thought. Recognize this. So whatever scriptures are saying, knowingly or unknowingly, you are already practicing it in your life. But you have to give it the right direction. That's all. You have to do it consciously. You have to do it consciously. I can't understand how can you experience anything without a thought. Don't you experience sleep without a thought? Because if you are thinking, you cannot sleep. Then you are dreaming. So you know that mind became thought free. And you were there. That's why you can make a comment about it after waking up, isn't it? So will be the case when we wake up from this waking state. That is the Turiya state. That is the fourth state.
Swamiji, is not happiness not a thought-free experience?
No. Happiness can lead to sorrow also. If it is not permanent happiness, if it is not pure happiness, which is called bliss in other words, then it is okay. But that cannot be known through the mind. That is your nature. If you are searching for happiness, it is a foolish search. You cannot, objectively, you can never experience happiness permanently. Objective happiness will be because of something, and that same thing can become a source of misery also. You are eating food and you are enjoying the dosa. One, two, three, the same food in one sitting can become a source of misery. Isn't it? I want tea. Ah, it's 4 o'clock now, I must enjoy. And you take the tea, you take first sip. Everything was geared towards taking enjoyment. You are so expecting, and the tea burns your tongue. From that very moment onwards, it becomes a source of misery. Isn't it? So what is the point of going after such happinesses? We are going for permanent happiness, in which there is no joy, and the opposites of joy and sorrow are not there. There is no, sometimes it is there, sometimes it is not like that. No, it is a permanent state. Satchit Anand, that Anand is a unbroken happiness. Unbroken happiness. And that cannot be experienced by thought, that cannot be experienced through an experience, that cannot be experienced through any object, that cannot be experienced through any emotion, that cannot be experienced through any relationship, that cannot be experienced through involving in the world or withdrawing from the world. No. Mind involves in the world and withdraws from the world. But that unbroken happiness is your essential nature. So the whole idea of this whole approach is you recognize that you are the unchanging principle. All changes are taking place because you are. And people are not able to see it. So we begin from the world, then we come to the body, that you have been unchanging and the body has been changing, breath has been changing and you have been never changing, mind, emotions have been changing and you have been the observer, concepts have been changing, thoughts are coming and going and you have been the observer. And slowly, slowly, you start getting an idea, yeah man, I have always been the observer. Then who is now? A curiosity has to be ignited, that who is this me who is observing everything? Why can't I be that all the time? Why can't I be that? Why do I get distracted from the objects of the world? And that is, was told, that because of vikshepa and because of manorajya we get disturbed. Because we interact intensely with the world. Because when we do actions in the world, we expect some results. And that leaves an impression. And that will only happen when your attention is not on the substratum or the conscious self. So act we must. Let the action happen. Don't get involved in it. Your attention should be, either you remain observer of the action, if you can't do that, before the action, remember the Lord. During the action, remember the Lord. After the action, whatever the result will be, good, bad, ugly, accept it as prasad of the Lord. And if you keep doing this for some time, mind will be automatically free of unwanted thoughts. It will start getting purified. In this way, the Dvaita Viveka Prakarana concludes, Jivan Mukte Parakashtha, Jivan Mukte Parakashtha, Jiva Dvaita Vivarjanat, Jiva Dvaita Vivarjanat, Labhyate Savato Tredam, Labhyate Savato Tredam, Ishadvaitad vivechitam, ईशद्वैताद्विवेचितम्। जीवन मुक्ते पराकाष्ठा, द फाइनल अबोर्ड, द अल्टीमेट, द फाइनल डेस्टिनेशन, द एक्मे ऑफ योर जर्नी, द कंक्लूजन ऑफ योर जर्नी, व्हाट इज दैट? जीवन मुक्ते, दैट इज लिबरेशन। Here it is told, the final abode of Jivan Mukta is gained by rejecting the duality created by the Jiva. So what was the duality created by the Jiva? The mental creation, isn't it? Mental creation is only because of subject-object. And that subject-object interaction, objects keep changing, subject keeps interacting with the objects, and thinks he's continuous, and another fictitious entity is created called the ego. Isn't it? Objects keep changing. And in this way, therefore, this jiva dvaita is inquired and discriminated from the isha dvaita in this chapter. So what was the topic of this chapter? Dvaita vivek. Duality, discrimination or duality. And then the topic began. What is this duality? It is of two types. It is duality of the Ishvara and the duality of the Jiva. What is Ishvara's duality? Can you do anything about Ishvara's duality? Nothing can be done. Why? He is beyond the Prakriti. Can you do anything about space, air, fire, water, earth? No, I don't want space. You can't remove it. I want the fire to be cold. You cannot do it. You can't. If the hunger comes, I don't want to be hungry. You can't do anything about it. It will come. And when you desire, I want to be hungry now, it will not come. So natural, the heart beating, the space, the sun, sunrise, sunsets, the sun's nature, the water's nature, the bodily functions, the Ishvara becoming, interacting with Prakriti and then entering into Prakriti, and the phenomena of Jiva, the phenomena of creating an equipment and entering into that equipment. Till here is the Ishvara Srishti. So the Ishvara out of himself created the being, and that being he entered. Till here is the phenomena. This is called Jiva. But this Jiva is not one per person. It is a phenomena. We explained last time, many classes before, light is a phenomena. Light is not one bulb. Light is not per bulb, there is no light. Even if one bulb fuses, the principle of light continues. Exactly the same way, take another example at a more personal level. The life is experienced. What do you experience yourself as at this moment? The body, isn't it? And the life is expressing through this body. Do you at any time, you're thinking all the time, I am also the liver, I am also the stomach, I am also the large intestine, I am also the head, I am also the eyes, I am also the right leg, and I am also the left leg. You don't keep thinking like this. You take yourself as one, isn't it? But is this one body not made up of many, many parts? Zillions of cells? That same life force is expressing through each cell. Through each organ. But that one organ says, no, I have an independent existence. I think I am liver, and that is stomach, and that is heart, and that is eyes, and I am different to them. But the life force expressing through all of them is one only, isn't it? You can experience that within you. Exactly the same way. The total person, the phenomena of Lord expressing through total equipment is one. till here is Jiva, Ishwara Srishti. Then what has happened after that? Just like each consciousness expressing through each organ or each cell gets identified with that organ, with that body, with that form that they are expressing through, and starts thinking, I am something. Whole body is functioning because of me. If I stop functioning, who is this? The body will cannot. See? The waker says the whole world is because of me. Dreamer says the whole world is because of me. Deep sleeper says the whole world is because of me. I am the source. But the source is someone, the presence is other than waker, dreamer, deep sleeper. See? The life expressing through fingers. The fingers say, oh, we are very important. Nobody gives me importance, you know. I make the food go into the mouth. If there is some problem in the eye, then I rub it. And then I scratch and I this. If I'm not there, what can he do? He can't do anything. Accident happens, hand is cut, you continue to survive. Nothing happens to the total. If one wave dies or one wave is born, the ocean remains complete. Nothing happens to the ocean. Similarly, nothing happens to the consciousness, whether waker is there or not there, dreamer is there or not there, deep sleeper is there or not there. Nothing happens. This is the Ishwara phenomena. Jiva phenomena, that same consciousness which was a witness of everything, now unknowingly, inadvertently gets identified with the form. The moment it gets identified with the form, subject-object duality is created. Mind comes into being. The moment mind comes into being, hell breaks loose. Now, that mind, that duality which is caused at the level of the mind, it is of two types. That which is accepted by the scriptures and that which is not accepted by the scriptures. See? So what is accepted by the scriptures? Okay, it is there. Then what can you do? Utilize the mind, utilize the duality of the mind to... Now you have found that you are in this situation, what can you do about it? Now utilize your equipment to go back to your source. This is accepted by the scriptures. Then what is not accepted by the scriptures? Two things, Tivra and Mandam. Tivra is anger, greed, jealousy, hypocrisy, arrogance and envy and these six things are not accepted by the scriptures. Manorajyam. Imagination, fantasizing, habitual thinking, this is building castles in the air, this is not accepted by the scriptures. So one is intense, kama krodha lobha moha mada matsarya, and one is mild, which is this manorajya. But both of them are an impediment to come back to yourself. Yes?
Two questions now. So can you say the mind is nothing but the consciousness identified with the body?
Mind is nothing but the
consciousness identified with the body.
Yes, yes. Yes, we can say that way.
Okay. Now we say Manorajya is a weak duality, but why there's a lot of explanation here is told only about that weaker one and not about Kama Krodha. Jiva
Srishti is two type. So it was told, no? Examples were given for the Tivra also it was given. Yeah. Verse 46, check 43 to 46. Shastri Dvaitam.
Lot of explanations given.
No, no, not.
Control the Manorajya.
Because the Manorajya is the cause and the kama krodha lobha moha mada matsarya, they are the effects. Deep sleep is the cause, waking and dream is the effect. So manorajya is subtle. But when you are living, anger is more real for you. And if you keep reacting at the anger, more impressions will keep getting created. So you have to have an integrated approach. You have to work on the anger, greed, jealousy also, and you have to work on manorajya also. So you reduce the source of disturbance, and whatever is expressing from that source as anger, greed, desires, etc., etc., you remain equanimous, undisturbed towards them. Don't try to fix it. If you try to fix it, you are giving attention to anger. Instead, who is observing this anger is expressing? Go back to the source. See, it was told, so if you have a mind, because control of mind and single-pointedness are known to be the means of self-realization. So instead of focusing on anger, greed, jealousy, etc., etc., instead of making the mind concentrated on anger, you put that capacity of the mind to become single-pointed on the truth. See, here it was told, Bodhad urdhvam cha taddheyam jivan mukti prasiddhaye kamadi klesha bandhena yuktasya nahi muktata. Verse 51. Even after self-realization, these two are worthy of rejection for getting firm abidance in the jivan mukta state. A person under the influence of the bondage of misery is born out of desires, etc., is not meant for jivan mukti indeed. So, one must not justify the intense and the mild ones, the manorajya and the, you must not justify. If you justify, then you are trying to prove to yourself that I am right. The desire is there, that I am right, others are wrong. Duality is maintained. And a new impression is getting created that world is not understanding that I am right. And then you want to, again and again, it will. The only way to sublimate this is to go back to the self, to the source. Who is watching this? Who is knowing that this anger is coming, this greed is coming, this desire is coming, this jealousy is coming, this arrogance is coming? You are knowing it. You are observing it. Even while I am speaking, I am observing that this speech is taking place, isn't it? Even while you are asking me the questions, you know that this question, this doubt has arisen in your mind and you are expressing it. The whole thing is happening in front of your presence, isn't it? You are illuminating those thoughts. You are watching. That's why you are able to speak about it. So we use the words, I understood, I did not understand. That is because of our identification with the mind. But the fact that I understood, you understand that the mind understood or did not understand. You are watching that the mind has understood or not. You are watching the mind, it has not understood. And therefore, the mind puts up another question. That also you know that the mind is putting the question. So find out who is this one who is watching all the time. And if that is not work, if it is not, you are not able to abide in that, then at the same time, slow down the imagining and fantasizing. Asking questions, having doubts is also an imagination, understand this, which is being expressed grossly. Any doubt, any question, any confusion, anything about this world, essentially is a manorajya only, isn't it? Manorajya is happening inside the mind, you are fantasizing. And when we make that fantasy or that doubt or that imaginary doubt, which is existing in its own absence, why? Mind is existing in its own absence. Just like the waves is existing in its own absence. And we become very serious and sincere about it and we grossify it as speech, as and communicate isn't it? Sometimes we don't communicate to others, we communicate to ourselves only, inside the mind only. Then speech is not required, but mental thoughts are going on. So what is happening inside is Manorajya. When that Manorajya expresses, it's doubt, questions, clarity, confusions, agitations, frustrations, depressions, liberations, bondages. That is the expression of Manorajya. Nice thought. I never thought it that way. Isn't it? So, curb, pure, the impact of Manorajya, you try to slow down. How do you do that? Then the exercise was given, Dirgham Pranamam Uccharyam, Manorajyam Viliyate. And that was, with that practice, it was told that, there was one more important. To focus attention on the self, that is also important. It, just like that, it is not enough. Buddha tattvena dhi dosha shunya naikanta vasina. Buddha tattvena, know the tattva, keep your attention on the essence. Keep the attention on the presence. What's the time? Keep the attention on the essence. Keep the attention on the presence. Buddha tattvena. Dhi dosha. By doing that, the impurity of the intellect, dhi, it will get removed. You cannot remove the impurity that is present in the intellect by thinking of the impurity. Remember this. You cannot. You cannot think about the waking world and go to sleep. You understand? Till you are thinking of the waking world, sleep is not possible. Till you are thinking of sleep as a thought, sleep is not possible. See? So, Buddha Tattvena. So, go to your, think about your essence. Know your essence, that you are alive, and be curious, be adventurous, be be eager to know yourself as yourself. What is this? Who is knowing everything? I can understand this, I can observe that it is, then every time why do I fall into identification? Come back. What is its nature? They say it is like this. Then why am I behaving like this? Keep coming back, keep coming back, keep coming back to it. It's initially faith. Faith is required that it is there. Why it is? Initially you may think it is there as a third entity. You have to recognize it as the subjective self. And then what will happen as a result of it? Dhi doshat. The impurities, dosha, the aberrations of the mind, of the intellect, they will start melting away. And when they melt away, then what do you do? Ekanta vasina, then become quiet, then live alone, then live in solitude. Alone does not mean run away from the world. Even while you are living in the world, you are living, you experience that you are with yourself. Your attention is totally introverted. When you find yourself in that disposition, then what do you do? So that you don't again fall back into the world and get disturbed, whatever the inner itches are there, which is called Manorajya, you try to sublimate that. How do you do that? Pranavam dirgha uccharyam. More important is the first sentence, Buddha tattvena. But everything else, the second line, dirgham pranava uccharyam manorajyam vijiyate, that is a helpful tool. The more you do the second line, verse number 62, the more you do the second line, elongated chanting of Om, your clarity your focus on the self will become natural. It will be more abiding. When I use focus, initially mind is focusing on the self, isn't it? But afterwards, that, how can you focus on self? You cannot focus. It is beyond the mind. But it, initially it will remain as a thought. And somewhere, as Manorajya becomes less and less, suddenly you find yourself witnessing all the time. And in this way, where are we? The final abode of Jivan Mukta is gained by rejecting the duality created by the Jiva. So, where is the duality of the Jiva created? In the mind. In the mind. So, everything that I just explained was how to deal with the mind. Therefore, this Jiva Dvaita is inquired and discriminated from Isho Dvaita in this chapter. Nothing can be done about the Ishvara Dvaita, duality created by Ishvara. Nothing can be done about the phenomena. Nothing can be done that you are appearing in this particular. You can't do anything about it. You can't do anything about the world. It is like that only. Now, question is, now that I am here, how can I, as you said, happiness, how can I gain permanent happiness? Scriptures say it is my essential nature. What is this essential nature? First define. He is the eternal witness. What does witnessing mean? Start writing it down. Yeah, I am watching. I am the subject. This world is the object of knowledge. I am the subject. This body is the object of knowledge. I am the object. This breath is the object of knowledge. I am the subject. These emotions are the object of knowledge. I am the subject. This intellect with its various concepts and thoughts is the object of knowledge. Oh my God. When you stay with it for some time, you will realize that I am not the thoughts. Then who am I? Then who am I? Do I need to answer that question? Do I need to answer that question? No. But this question will come, then who am I? Don't answer. Just sit silently. You are that presence. You are that light in whose presence the thoughts come and go, the emotions come and go, the breaths come and go, the body is aging, the world is coming and going, the waker, dreamer, deep sleeper come and go. All the roles that the mind plays come and go. You have always been the observer. But out of inadvertence, because of Manorajya, you have started taking yourself to be an independent entity who is other and created a separate identity for yourself from the world. There is nothing like this. The cell in the pancreas will say, my world is the pancreatic world. I am not in the brain world. Brain cannot function because of pancreas. Brain cell says, I am in the brain world. So, different, each one is living in his own world, in his own family of cells. But what is your truth, looking at the whole body? They are all in me. The whole body is existing because of me. The day this life force goes out of the body, all these have got no meaning. So many cells have been born, so many cells have died over the last 50 years. But I have always remained the same. I have never experienced any loss or any gain because of the birth or the death of the various cells. Isn't it? start looking at it not only at the level of body, but look at it as a total. That the whole world is also because of this conscious principle that I am. Don't go and tell people this. You will get a thrashing of your life. You will get arguments, you will get discussions, and you will get distracted. This is to be done on the seat of meditation, when you are all by yourself. Ekantavasina, that time you bring these thoughts up. Even though you don't understand, scriptures are presenting you these ideas, you don't want to come to a conclusion, because you cannot. Mind cannot come to a conclusion. But all we can do is give you analogy, that's all. And that idea leaves you with a no idea. And suddenly you find distinct from all expressions. You find yourself to be the source of the source on whose surface all this experience is taking place. So in this way, Ishvara Srishti is not a problem, Jiva Srishti is the one to deal with. Nothing can be done about the Ishvara Srishti, but because it is not in our control. But Jiva Srishti is in our control. So let's take charge, do something about it. And how do you do something about it? Buddha Tattvena, by contemplating on the self, by contemplating on the essence, by contemplating on the source. Only by that way you can purify your intellect. And also, to it, support is given through chanting of elongated Oms. In this way, we conclude this chapter on Dvaita Vivek. Essentially, it is a matter of changing the vision and understanding the Jeev-Jagat-Ishwara relationship in correct perspective. In that clear vision, there is an end of all sorrow, there is only serenity, only prasada buddhi. And then such a person is comfortable everywhere. He doesn't want to run away from anything, he doesn't want to run towards anything. Everything that is happening at that moment is right. He takes everything that is happening to him in his life as a prasad of the Lord. Every thought that is appearing, once your attention has stabilized on the intellect, on the essence, then the thoughts that are appearing in your mind are also taken as the prasad of the Lord. Because you are not taking any ownership of those thoughts. So if they are coming, it must be the Lord's will. Nothing for me to do about it. See? And this is the way to remain in Ananda. This is the way to remain in Paramananda. Hari Om Tat Sat. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om. Just for 5 minutes, we'll sit in meditation.